I haven't done a verbal preface for any of my videos before, but if there's one video that was going to get it, it would be this one. This particular video is a retelling of many of my personal experiences and thoughts, rather than analysis, though there will be some, and will be breaching a number of extremely serious topics such as suicide, depression, bullying, social-related stresses like anxiety and peer pressure, and more uplifting topics like friendship and forgiveness. While every single one of these topics deserves its own video, some will be highlighted more than others in this video. It goes without saying that I am no psychologist or therapist. My experiences are not yours. If you do seriously need help, there are links in the video description such as the Suicide Prevention Hotline and the Crisis Text Line. This video also includes significant spoilers for A Silent Voice. If you haven't watched the movie, I would highly recommend you do so before coming back to this video. I'm sorry for the lengthy intro, but I thought it was necessary. If we all take a moment to reflect on our journeys, on our pasts, on everything that has led us to this moment in time, I would imagine there's at least a couple memories that stick out. A moment when you did something rather foolish or cruel. And the haunting feelings that accompany those memories when you look back on them. As I reflect on my 2020, the year of my graduation from university, it has been an extremely bittersweet year. And of course, this has translated over to movies and shows that I've had a chance to watch this year as well. Koe no Katachi, or A Silent Voice, is much like its title. In many ways, the voice, or what is spoken to the viewer, is silent. We're not told why certain things happen, or what people are thinking in any given moment. Rather, we see it through their expressions and their actions. The movie is built off the many languages of nonverbal expression. Truthfully, there aren't many stories that are told from the perspective of the bully. I mean, who wants to empathize with someone who intentionally hurts others? But it's a little different in this circumstance. I mean, Shoya doesn't necessarily have a typical background. It's not as if he's a misunderstood kid with trouble at home. He just rationalizes what he's doing in a twisted, childish way that makes sense to him. The movie is very subtle. If you were to look at it with simply visuals, you would be missing out on so much. You would be able to interpret and get the general feel of certain scenes. But when it gets mixed in with the soundtrack, the ambience, the voice acting, you're able to take in the entirety of the character's emotions and the thoughts that accompany those emotions. It's one of those types of movies that I know resonates with a lot of people aside from myself. What we say to one another is truly far more than our words can really express. We as the viewer may not know a character's thoughts and feelings by narration, but rather in the way they carry themselves. For example, the contrast between Shoya's childhood and Shoya's high school experiences are strikingly different, evident by the way he walks, the way he looks, and the way he interacts with people. I wager that the childhood self you look back on interacted with others far differently than the way you interact with people now. I have two core beliefs about people, that after physiological needs, there are two things that every person in this world wants. They want to be loved, and they want to be understood. That beneath the exterior we present to the world, in our innermost thoughts and feelings, there is often an excruciating disconnect. When I reflect on A Silent Voice, it doesn't feel like I watched a movie. It feels like I lived it, and I genuinely mean that. In the first part of the film, the movie shows us Shoya's inability to understand and communicate with Shoko on every level. Through writing, hand movements, expression, touch, and audible voice. We see her reach out in every way possible to him. And the worst part about it all, the worst part, is that Shoya uses those very methods of communication to abuse her. Through writing, he insults her. Through hand movement, he tosses dust and sand at her. Through her expressions, he finds himself becoming frustrated and lashing out. Through touch, he throws pebbles at her. And finally, through audible voice, Shoko's last attempt, they get into a fight in the classroom. When I was watching this film with my friend Kevin, he admitted to me afterwards that he would have stopped halfway through the childhood segment because he found it unbearable. It was only because I was there that he continued the movie. And that reminded me of something. See, when I look back on the first time I saw the childhood memories of Shoya and his classmates bullying Shoko, I remember pausing the movie because I just couldn't go on. It made me angry, frustrated, and disgusted. So when Shoya's classmates turn on him, I felt these feelings that I couldn't quite describe. I was happy he was getting what he deserved. And yet, I got this excruciating pain in my chest, this heaviness that I still feel from time to time. When I reflect on this movie, I realize that I've played the role of nearly every character, from beginning to end. I have been the bully. I have said and done things that I wish I could have never said or done, like Shoya. And I have sought redemption, reconciliation, forgiveness, and a desire to be better. I have been the bullied, and made to feel small and insignificant. I have felt so awful afterwards that I wasn't really sure what to do but put on a mask. I have hated myself so deeply that I wanted to die, like Shoko. I have been a complicit bystander, feeling awful about the situation, but contributing to the bullying indirectly, doing nothing to stop or right the wrongs in front of me, like Kwai. I have let my fears of peer pressure guide me. I have been the observer, hearing about something secondhand and making my own judgments about the situation, based on what I know, like Mashiba. I have been the friend standing up for my friends, regardless of their past, like Nagatsuka. I have struggled with every single one of these, and more, and still sometimes struggle with some of them. I am no saint. I often feel like a hypocrite. Growing up, I was always seen as a good kid. I rarely got into trouble, and I was usually seen as an example for other kids to follow at church and school, and I was fairly popular. In a lot of ways, I was like Shoya. Fairly carefree, without too many worries. But there were a few times when I said some mean things or took actions that weren't to the level of what Shoya and his friends did, but I would still constitute my actions as bullying, like when all of the girls ditched Shoko on the playground. At the same time, there aren't exactly levels of bullying, at least in my eyes. I suppose certain actions might get you in trouble more than others, but at the end of the day, all of it is wrong. All of it is twisted. And I feel nothing but shame looking back on those memories of mine. Somewhere along the way, when I got to middle school and high school, I lost that part of myself that was carefree and happy. Looking people in the face was scary. Seeming vulnerable was something I actively sought to distance myself from, and there were few things less discouraging to me than my own thoughts. And of course, an unhealthy mindset just becomes more unhealthy, until it becomes one of the worst things you can ever really deal with. When Shoya initially turns away from helping Nagatsuka with the student trying to take his bike, I felt that. I wondered, how many times have I turned away from situations where someone needed my help, but I was too afraid to step in? When Shoya imagines the conversations his classmates are having about him, I wondered, how many times have I let my own mind spiral into an abyss that eventually turned into something far darker? I'm not sure when I realized I was depressed. Somewhere in the middle of my sophomore year of high school, I guess. Depression wasn't like I flipped a switch and suddenly I was moody, upset with myself, and often outwardly sad. It was a long process that took a toll on me. But I was told to chin up, and push forward regardless. After all, these things will pass in time. So I put on a mask. A pained smile day to day as I continued what seemed to be an insufferable existence. I was exhausted. I felt alone, even though I had friends. But looking back, how many of those friends really knew what was going on? I was just so dissatisfied with myself and the person I was. Eventually, these things led to a breaking point. My depression led me to immense self-loathing, much like Shoya and Shoko. It is fairly clear to the viewer how it affects Shoya, since much of the movie is from his perspective. How he views himself, others, and in the way he handles himself. For Shoko, there are no particular signs of her self-loathing and depression. Maybe the fact that she apologizes constantly, but it's never clear until the fireworks scene late into the movie. two sides of the same coin, just manifested in different ways. And then there's this thought. This thought that maybe the world would be better off without me in it. We as viewers see how Shoya and Shoko's relationship develops throughout the course of the film. From their first awkward meeting, to the moment he saves her from her suicide attempt off the balcony. Their relationship saves them both. Two sides of the same coin. While I consciously made the choice to step back from what was my ledge, I remember rationalizing all of the moments leading up to it and deciding that, just maybe, life was still worth living, somehow. But if I wanted to change, to really change, the process would be long and difficult. In getting to that point, forgiving myself for those thoughts and asking for forgiveness from those I've wronged has been really hard. But it's been doable through the relationships that I've been blessed to have. For all of Nagatsuka's goofy antics throughout the film, he says something really pertinent. Friendship lies somewhere beyond things like words and logic. And it's true. When I was growing up, I never really gave it much thought as to what made people my friends. We had similar interests, and that was enough. That made us friends, right? And as I grew older, those shared interests didn't really seem like they were enough anymore. Were we really friends if I didn't know common facts about your life? Like where you were headed for college or what you were planning to do after high school? Friends should know at least that much, right? The more I've thought about Nagatsuka's quote, the more I've thought about friendship, what it means to be a friend and to have a friend. It has only become more apparent to me that the relationships we have in our lives, that the friends and family we have around us play a pivotal role in what it means to live. That sense of human connection that gives our lives meaning. That special something that sometimes still seems so distant to me. But when my friends have asked me what's wrong, when my friends have noticed a change in my body language or demeanor, it makes me feel like that sense of human connection is actually attainable, somehow. One of the most overlooked scenes in the movie is when Shoko and Shoya have a brief conversation concerning the rumors about Shoya as they walk through the hallway. When Shoko asks him if he's alright, Shoya gives her a genuine response, no facade or mask to hide behind. He simply tells her his problems, that he doesn't fit in at school, that he can't look at people's faces because he's afraid of what he'll see. And as I think about the entirety of the film, not once does Shoya audibly tell anyone else of his problems and challenges. And you know what? She listens. And the two of them have this dialogue where they're both listening to each other, that Shoya is bringing his problems to her, and Shoko is listening. She understands him, and I think that says something pertinent. That it's okay to tell people how you feel about something, and what you struggle with. We aren't meant to walk life alone. The road to climbing out of the abyss is a long one, but the silent voice reminds me that it is possible. That the path may be arduous, painful, winding, but with the help of human connection, maybe one day we'll properly be able to listen to the voices of others, and maybe one day, we can change, maybe starting now, that while we can't change our past, we can change our futures, that maybe one day we'll finally be understood and loved, that we'll finally be able to assure ourselves that we are worth it, every time. Hey everyone, Echoes here. I hope you've had a great start to your December. Thank you for watching this video on a silent voice. I hope this longer video makes up for my absence of a little more than a month. If you did enjoy the video, I would really appreciate a like, favorite, subscription, or a comment. I honestly don't have the words to tell you all how grateful I am for all of the support. Have a great week, and I hope to see you all again soon.